Welcome to Hanover Park.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Wakanda forever. Thank you so much for coming out to our Sister Cities program, our annual Black History Month celebration. We are so honored to have the opportunity to represent the village on Black History Month and to celebrate the heritage of our African American culture. So once again, why don't you give yourselves a big hand for showing up. I want to, first of all, we're going to join in the singing of the Black National Anthem, Lift Every Voice. But before I do that, I know a lot of times you go to these programs and you sing this song, but you don't know the history of the song, you don't know the relevance of the song. So I just wanted to share a little bit about the history and the relevance of the song and maybe make it more meaningful. For some of you, this may be redundant. For others, it may be new information. So allow me to share that. Lift Every Voice and Sing, which is often referred to as the Black National Anthem, was written as a poem by NAACP leader James Weldon Johnson. And it was set to music by his brother, John Rosamond Johnson. Now, it was first performed in public in the Johnson's hometown of Jacksonville, Florida, as part of a celebration of Abraham Lincoln's birthday on February 12, 1900, by a choir of 500 school children at the segregated school, Stanton School, where James Weldon Johnson was principal. So you see the history of this song. It started out as a poem, and it was later turned into music and written and scored by his brother. James Weldon Johnson was a diplomat, a songwriter, and a civil rights activist. He's widely celebrated for his leadership in the NAACP, where he began working in 1917. In 1920, he was the first African American to be chosen as an executive secretary of the organization. You know, I bet many of you didn't know that the NAACP, when it first started, was headed and founded and directed by all Caucasians. And it wasn't until 1920 when he was elected as the first African American to be executive secretary of the organization. So it kind of brings everything into full circle. And you can see how throughout the civil rights movement and throughout time and throughout history, all cultures and all races have all worked collaboratively to advance the efforts of Black Americans and African Americans. And so when we have these African American history events, it's important that we acknowledge that we're all in this together, and we've always been in this fight together. Johnson established his reputation as a writer and was known during the Harlem Renaissance for his poems, novels, and anthologies, collecting both poems and spirituals of Black culture. Now, he was appointed under President Theodore Roosevelt as a U.S. consul in Venezuela and Nicaragua for most of the period from 1906 to 1913. In 1934, he became the first African-American professor to be hired at New York University. Later in life, he served as a professor of creative literature and writing at Fisk University, a historically Black college and university. Also, you may have heard it referred to as HBCU. So, this is the history behind Lift Every Voice and Sing, and I just thought I'd share that with you because some of you may not have known that and what the genesis of the song is. So if you'll join me now. Now I do have, the words will be, and we'll be singing along. Sometimes this is not an easy song to sing. It's kind of like the national anthem. It's not an easy song to sing. So we'll be singing along, and the words will be, so we'll do it karaoke style, if that's all right. So, so if you'll please join me as we sing, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Joy, sing, the place of our God where we may be.
Today. I'm always glad to belong to a community that celebrates its diversity and educates its community about things that are important to the families that live here. So I've always thought very highly of Hanover Park. It's one of my favorite communities that I represent. And once again, I'm happy to spend time here with all of you. So thank you for including me. And I cannot wait to see what they have in store.
Thank you. We also have Gail Tobin from the Hanover branch of the Schomburg Library. Gail Tobin, thank you very much. Entering the room, we have Poplar Creek Library trustee, Eva Porter. And so at this time, we're going to bring forth our Mayor Craig for the Black History Month proclamation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. One trustee that wasn't mentioned was Trustee Herb Park. He's just a shy guy, you know. But we are truly blessed in Hanover Park with our diversity, acknowledging that diversity and providing leadership for that. So let me read the proclamation. Should have brought my glasses. I'm short light always helps, but I can use this, I think. Oh, there we go. Thank you. It's tough getting old and the vision goes. Whereas much of Hanover Park's honor, strength, and stature can be attributed to the diversity of cultures and traditions that are celebrated by the residents of this great village. And whereas African Americans have played significant roles in the history of this nation's economic, cultural, spiritual, and political development while working tirelessly to maintain and promote their culture and history. And whereas as a result of their determination, hard work, intelligence, and perseverance, African Americans have made valuable and lasting contributions to our community, achieving exceptional success in all aspects of society, including business, education, politics, science, and the arts. And whereas in 1976, Black History Month was formally adopted to honor and affirm the importance of Black history throughout our American experience, which goes back thousands of years and includes some of the greatest, most advanced, and innovative societies in our history that we can all draw inspiration from. And whereas Black History Month is a time for all Americans to remember the stories, the teachings of those who helped build our nation, took a stance against prejudice to build lives of dignity and opportunity, advanced the cause of civil rights, and strengthened families and communities. And whereas during Black History Month, all Americans are encouraged to reflect on past successes and challenges of African Americans and look to the future to continue to improve society so that we live up to the ideals of freedom, equity, and justice. Now, therefore, I, Rodney S. Craig, Mayor of the Village of Hanover Park, do hereby proclaim the month of February 2019 to be Black History Month in the Village of Hanover Park, Illinois, and encourage all residents to join us in honoring the many contributions made by African Americans and attending Black History Month celebration hosted by the Sister Cities Committee on February 9th, 2019 at 12 noon at the Hanover Park Village Hall, dated the 7th day of February 2019. And just, I'm always honored to be a part coming here. And recently, I have a shared experience. On WTTW, there's a program. And in this program, they dig down and they drill down on the history of individuals. And recently, there was one with two Black individuals. I wouldn't plan to talk about this, but I can't remember their names. It would have been important to do that. But the they went back, and there was like a gap. You know, it was like a stop. When back in the 1800s with slavery, and people barely used their own names. And so the history of those families would like end. Well, now with some of the new technology and DNA, well, they can kind of jump over that. And they can really continue on back thousands of years following the history. It was so intriguing and so enlightening that I was really excited to see that. If any of you ever have an opportunity to look at that program, because I think it's reoccurring on the channels today, take a moment, because it really opens up the world for understanding how we all aspire to work together, to join together. We had a dark moment in our history. And so we're past that, and we're growing together. And my board reflects that. So, Herb, thank you for inviting me to read the proclamation.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
All right. If you look in your seats, you'll see that there's a flyer for the Waubonsie Valley High School Black Student Alliance. We were called by the people associated with this program, which I think is a wonderful effort to engage our children and to do some positive activities in the community. And I'm just going to ask Ms. Shirley Prunty if she will just come and just give you a quick word about this program and how we can maybe support her in this effort.
And I am one of the directors of Gospel Morale and Entertainment. The founder is located in the corner here. Her name is Nastasha Prunty. She's the founder and sole owner of Gospel Morale and Entertainment. The purpose of this organization is to promote positivity in the community. How many of you know that our children are in trouble? They are truly in trouble. So it's up to us, and I mean collectively, to pull our kids to a safe haven. They have so many talents, so much gift that has been extended to them, and the only way that they can do that is for us to promote positivity in the community, and that's across all counties. So I'm here today to present to you that Waubonsie Valley High School is actually having a fundraiser. Everyone talked about our kids do not have activities. No one's supporting our kids. So it's not up to me, it's up to us collectively to support our kids. It doesn't matter whether I gave birth to them or not, they're our children. Regardless of the color of their skin, they're our children. And it's up to us to save them. I am asking for your support. We're a non-for-profit organization, so we're not funded in any way. So we're here just to invite you out, if you can. If you can't, just pray That always works. So just pray about it, and really, you know, we just want to encourage the kids and to really bring life back into them, because they are truly gifted. So thank you for your time, and I so appreciate you allowing me to come. So many places have shut us out. And it's really sad to say, because we talk about what we want for our kids, but when we go to places and tell them that our kids are in trouble, no one wants to help. Don't leave it to one group to do it. We all have to do it. So I'm appealing to you today to just support. Okay? Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
It is important that we don't work in silos, you know, that we reach out to other groups that are doing positive works, and that we support those groups as well. Even when there's no direct benefit, I mean, she's not from Hanover Park and she's not from our county, but she's doing good work on behalf of our kids. And to me, that supersedes all geographical and political and all of those type of boundaries. So thank you once again for sharing that with us. And now for our program. I don't want anyone to think that we are so naive as to think that we can give you an in-depth history of Black musical contributions throughout the ages in a short 2-hour program. So what we've done is that we've taken some highlighted moments, some snapshots through time of some historical contributions so that we can kind of build a narrative as to how music has shaped the lives of our culture historically, socially, politically, religiously, how music has played such an important role, but also how the African-American contribution to music has been instrumental in shaping the music and how it's presented and how it's received and the impact that it's had on not only America, but on the world. In August of 1619, a Dutch ship landed around 20 Negroes in Jamestown, Virginia. They came from Western Africa and were employed on the plantations as indentured servants. Black American history had begun. The Europeans, satisfied with their cheap workforce, enslaved them very early. By 1640, most Africans in Virginia were slaves. Singing while working has always been part of the African traditions. The work songs sung by the slaves were born from the transformation of African chants, the litanies of American fields. They dated from the second generation of slaves and were used as the link between original African music and the one developed when the slaves got in touch with Euro-American society. These songs were essentially sung a cappella, used to put rhythm into the slaves' work. They were for the most part improvised and characterized by the call and response pattern. The work songs reflected the situation of the blacks as slaves, and they died out after the breaking of the plantation system, but are said to have persisted in southern penitentiaries until the 1960s. We have a presentation now that we're gonna do. This is from the acclaimed film, 12 Years as a Slave.
Move along, huh? Yeah. Come on, Evan. Drive that bitch. Cut that gun. Move along, huh? Yeah, please do it, boy. Come on.
see that through the brutality of the field that the slaves managed to sing. And it was often to the dismay of the slave owners who couldn't understand what the singing was about. But we understand now that they understood then, that it was a messaging system as well as a method for encouraging the slaves to persevere, looking forward to that day when they would no longer be oppressed and when they would see freedom. This next song is a further demonstration of that, again from the acclaimed film 12 Years as a Slave. This is called Roll, Jordan, Roll. Were brought from the western shores of Africa to America, they were denied to participate and to practice the religion as they had known it. And they were further subject to heavy evangelization by the Christian ministers and the Christian culture here in America. So they had a dilemma. How did they maintain their African cultures and their African religions and those things that were inherent to their nature, but also participate and live cohesively within the American culture and hold on to those traditions which they were denied to participate in. So the song that we just witnessed, what would happen is that the African slaves saw themselves in a common bond with the Jewish people. And so they look back to the travails of the Jewish people, particularly during the time of Moses and the journey of the Exodus from Egypt for the Jews. And so they took that story and they made it their own. And so many of the songs that we see have Bible-related verses or related to the Bible. And the reason for that is because they were seeking for a way to express what they were feeling and what they were going through, but they had to do it in a medium that was allowed by the slave owners. And so they took those songs, and many times they took traditional hymns that were sung by white Christians, but then they added that African sauce to it. They put that African flavor, and they put that on it. And so they started with the syncopation and the clapping and the drums, which were not allowed. So they couldn't use the drums. So what they did was that they would take the clapping and they would also take the step. Because what they would do in order to allow that is that when they were working in the field, they would do a heel step. So when they would clap, they would step like that. And in order to keep a beat and to keep a rhythm, they wouldn't step with the toes because they were working.
And you can't work when you're stepping with your toes, so they would step with the heels, and they would work. And they would do that, and then they would tap and pick the cotton and go through and go through, and they would keep the fields and keep everybody syncopated in the music. So we've always been a creative people, and we've always been able to rise in the midst of adversity and come up with something beautiful and express it, and this is an example. Right now we're going to have a live performance by one of our talented performers, Ms. Carolyn Holland, accompanied by Chev Blackshear. Would you give them a hand? Let the church say amen.
Carolyn Hollins later in the program. After the field songs and the work songs, we progress to the Negro spirituals. And the Negro spirituals, again, came out of that oppression that the African Americans were expressing. In the 18th century, they were really revised by the slaves, again, who took traditional Occidental or European or Christian hymns and then turned them around with their own, sometimes with their own wording, with their own patterns, lyrical patterns, rhythm patterns, and they would change the songs to reflect the times that they were living in and some of the struggles that they were having to endure. So from the field songs, we made the progression to the Negro spirituals. It was born in the 18th century, and they compared, again, the slaves of the situation of the slaves following on with that tradition to the Jewish experience during the Exodus and the cries of the Jews of the Old Testament. It was very closely related, and there's always been that synergy between the African experience and the Jewish experience, and I think it's because of what was written many times in the book of Exodus and throughout the Bible. You know, a lot of those are poems, you know, that are written. We read them, but they were written as songs, and they were written as poems, even in Jewish history. They were songs, and so there was a revelation, I guess, to the Africans that realized, you know, here's music. And so they took those poems and they took those verses from the Bible and they applied musical patterns to them. This is "Let My People Go."
Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt.
Stretch out your running, come on, go down, break the Moses, way down in the land. Tell them,
why don't you let my people go
down, Moses, way down in Egypt land.
It's amazing that, as you saw with some of the images depicted on the screen, that through the harsh brutality of slavery, that the slaves were able to sing and to put forth that type of strength
in the midst of that type of suffering. And so what would happen is that these songs would migrate from plantation to plantation, and there would be messages in the song because they were not allowed to communicate with people in other plantations. There was no communication that was allowed. So they had to develop a system of communicating, and such was their ingenuity that they came up with using the songs and the patterns of the songs in order to communicate things such as when there was going to be a meeting, when they were going to steal away into the night to have their private services, when they were going to organize maybe an escape through the Underground Railroad and headed north. And so they used the music as a form and as an instrument of communication. This was, again, just an amazing feat by supposedly uneducated and unintelligent people, but they were anything but. They were enormously creative, enormously adaptable in being able to put together the different modes of communication that they came up with. In the vein of the Negro spirituals, we're going to ask Ms. Carolyn Hollins to please come, once again, come and join us. So that was the era of the Now you got to remember that there's a continuum of these music. They never actually stop,
right,
but they continue on and they sort of evolve into the next iteration of the music. And so they continue on in that manner. Now, the next thing that comes up is that we go into the period of time called the menstrual period. And it's very topical right now because of some of the news items that have revolved around blackface. And so I had planned this as part of the presentation before this became an issue in the news. So sometimes I said, well, maybe, you know, God just gives you a little, you know, a little direction on what to do, because this deals with the whole issue of blackface that came out of the menstrual tradition. What we hope to do in this presentation and in this video clip is to give you an idea of why it was begun, and also the sensitivity that a whole culture of people have toward the depiction of blacks or whites in blackface, and the offensive nature of it, and why even to this day it still is a very hurtful form, hurtful presentation and representation of the race. So this is a short 6-minute clip on blackface.
Even Bugs Bunny and Elmer Fudd blacked up.
And always in this song, sooner, we have come with their brother along.
Being plastic, isn't it?
One run all night.
For more than 100 years, white and then black performers wore dark makeup and created not only a popular theatrical form, but stereotypes that are still with us today. This makes you uncomfortable, doesn't it?
Absolutely. It does make me feel uncomfortable to talk about these things because they are incredibly disturbing and revolting.
Eric Lott, a professor at the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, says blackface represents a strange mix of envy, fascination, desire, and fear.
Explain the fear part to me. What are these white performers, what are these white people afraid of?
They're afraid of black groups, mobs, rising up and taking the power.
Minstrel shows began in the 1830s, and white performers used burnt cork or later black grease paint. Minstrelsy eventually became the most popular form of entertainment in the country.
Ah, yes.
I asked Margot Jefferson, the Pulitzer Prize-winning critic, to look at some images from the New York Public Library.
The shininess of the black against the big white clown's mouth, the hat, the overlong tailcoat, mocking. It always gives me the jolt that racist history does. Blackface is so tied to comedy, to people enjoying themselves, to people having fun, that rattles you still more.
Well, Mr. Tambo, you seem to be enjoying yourself this evening.
Enjoying myself, I sure is.
White minstrel performers claimed that what they did on stage was based on their perceptions of how black people lived.
Some of this came out of a genuine fascination with the music, the songs, the dances, the performance styles of black people.
But it's also where Jump Jim Crow was born, along with other characters depicted as lazy, lying, or buffoonish. Remember, this was all happening before the Civil War.
Slavery was all about creating visions, types, stereotypes of an entire race of people as subhuman in every way.
By the 1860s, African Americans began using blackface on stage.
Why on earth would a black performer put on blackface and demean him or herself?
Look, this is the 19th century. They had limited options. They were expected to.
Why?
Because it made the audiences comfortable. You can be fascinated, you can be excited, but you can always feel superior.
In effect, the black makeup on a black performer became a theatrical mask with many layers of meaning. Right. Professor Eric Watts.
The mask, I think, says to white audiences, You have nothing to fear. Go ahead, enjoy yourself. To black audiences, I think any number of things might have been communicated, like, can you believe that these people are making me put on this mask so they will be entertained? You know, in other words, it was a kind of winking to the black audience. But it gave black performers access to the stage.
One of the biggest black stars to come out of the minstrel tradition was Burt Williams, who wore blackface from vaudeville to Broadway.
It's clear that he was a genius of a performer.
But how did he reconcile performing in this demeaning art form?
He was very melancholy about it. He knew it was necessary for his career, as all other black performers knew it.
Minstrelsy on stage basically died out in the 1920s, but blackface lived on in the movies.
I'd walk a million miles for one of your smiles.
In 1927, Al Jolson starred in the pioneering talking picture, The Jazz Singer, playing a young man who prefers singing popular music rather than his family's traditional Hebrew prayers.
I don't want to look at. What reaction do you get?
I totally understand.
Wait a minute. I don't like the way he said that.
In the Our Gang comedies of the 1930s, Spanky appeared in blackface.
Buckley, did you say Spanky was in a lot of trouble?
Yes, sir.
The gag here is that the gang doesn't realize that that's Spanky in blackface until they actually see Buckley.
Hiya, Buckley.
Hiya, Buckley.
So the gist of it is that you put blackface makeup on anyone and they become black.
And that's supposed to be hilarious.
And it's supposed to be really funny.
When he grows up.
And it goes on. During the golden age of the Hollywood musical, Judy Garland.
When he walks down the street, folks will say, please to meet Mr. Franklin D. Roosevelt Jones.
Bing Crosby.
That's why we celebrate this blessed February day, Abraham.
Fred Astaire and many others, all blacked up. It's still in the culture.
It is too easy, I think, simply to dismiss the history of blackface as that racist stuff. And most of us are better than that. I don't think most of us are better than that. We are that. That's what we are.
You know, some people say in order to move forward, we need to put this stuff behind us, as painful, as just upsetting that it may be.
Well, you know, any form of history that gets suppressed or repressed or erased out, it comes back to haunt. What has to happen now is a discussion, an acknowledgement of this charged, complicated, painful history.
So as you can see, during this period of time in the presentation of minstrel music and in the blackface, it's not coincidental that this also was the time of the rise of Jim Crow laws throughout the United States, that black people, though they were no longer enslaved, and had many of them had made the journey from southern plantations to the northern cities, but they were still subjected to Jim Crow laws, which denied them their basic rights to freedom. They still didn't have the right to association, the right to housing, the right to vote, the right to equal schooling. So a lot of these things were still denied, even in most of the northern cities, as a result of the Jim Crow law. And blackface provided some cover for that by making it seem as if this was all hilarious and very entertaining, when in fact it was depictive of the times and the racial sensitivities or lack thereof in the times. This next video that we're going to show is from one of my personal heroes, and this is Mr. Paul Robeson, who was a noted author, scholar, actor, athlete, just an all-around Renaissance man before that term was even really kind of tossed around. Just one of my favorite people, and please, Paul Robeson.
There's an old man called Mississippi. That's the old man that I'd like to
Robeson was very instrumental in the beginning of the civil rights movement. He was a very strong advocate for Negro rights and for making sure that the plight of the Negro in America was not forgotten or relegated to the back pages of the paper or to the back pages of society. So he was just a very powerful, strong, dignified black man that was forced to live for a time in Europe because of the oppression and the bias that he received for the stances that he took. Again, a fantastic musician and one of my personal heroes. Speaking of that, during this time of ragtime and during this time of music, ragtime music which was made popular by Scott Joplin, who was famous for his inventive style on the keyboard, which is called ragtime. Chip, do you know any ragtime? Can you give us a ragtime riff? Come and give us a short ragtime riff, please. Yeah, so that was the music of the time, and Scott Joplin, of course, was the originator of that. And that theme kind of grew, and it was the birth of many other forms of music. This next video is a little self-indulgent, but I was able to perform in a theatrical production of the play Ragtime, and this is a scene from the end of that movie Ragtime.
Go out and tell our story, let it echo far and wide, make them hear you, make them hear you. How justice was our battle, and how justice was denied, make them hear you, make them hear you. And say to those who blame us for the way we chose to fight, that sometimes there are battles that are more than black or white. And I could not put down my sword when justice was my right. Make them hear you. Go out and tell our stories to your daughters and your sons. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. And tell them in our struggles we were not the only ones. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. Your sword can be a sermon or the power of a man. Teach every child to raise his voice and let my brothers stand. Will justice be demanded by 10 million righteous men? Make them hear you. Will they hear you? Oh, they hear you. Oh,
America was in the throes of maybe something that we hadn't seen again until maybe the 1960s. Women were pressing for the right to vote, the women's suffrage movement. The labor movement was gaining steam, and the right to organize as unions was also taking force. You had things like the Haymarket riots here in Chicago and some other activities and things that were going on. So it was a time of great turmoil, and this music accompanied the ragtime effort and the ragtime period in our musical history. So I thought that it was important that we pay homage to that. Next, we'll take a journey into the blues. The blues represented a time when it was the creation of black American people who were rejected and in isolation and in despair because of slavery and later on because of segregation. And it's widely assumed, especially among blues singers, that blues existed during slavery. However, according to some musicologists, it would have appeared in the 1880s and the 1890s. It seems unlikely that the consolidation of this type of music was the outcome of the convergence of the work song, the field holler, and the Negro spiritual traditions and European cultural elements such as Anglo-Scottish ballads. So blues was a combination of all of that mixed in with the ethos of the African-American experience and what they were going through. Blues became professionalized thanks to Negro theaters and was pronounced through blacks' migration at the beginning of the 20th century from the Deep South to the industrialized North. Just an aside, a good read on this migration is a book by Isabel Wilkerson called The Warmth of Other Suns. And if you want to get an in-depth idea of what the Great Migration was for African Americans from the Deep South to the cities of the North, I recommend Isabel Wilkerson, The Warmth of Other Suns, as a great read for that. The music was an opportunity to tell their life and their experiences in the New World. The blues in America and in the world was a significant step in blacks' achievement. We got a short video, and then we're going to have some really good performances by our guest entertainers. This is Rick Stone, who's a performer at the Black Ensemble. Well, no, this is Sweet Honey and the Rock. I'm sure you've heard of this. It's just an acclaimed gospel group.
Wait in the water, children, wait in the world of the man's gonna trouble the world. Come on, wait in the world, you gotta wait.
The water, see the dressed in green.
God's going to the water.
You know they're moving down to that Jordan stream.
Well, God's going to the water.
Amazing. So make sure that you take advantage of that. At this time, I want to bring up some of our performers that are here to grace us with their talents. And I'd like to introduce Mr. Alfred Golden, who will come first, and Shanalo Brown. Okay, Ms. Shanalo Brown, thank you. And, No, you first. Alfred tossed the baton to you. Okay.
All right, thank you. How are everyone this afternoon? Can you all hear me?
Yes.
I can't hear me. I'm going to do a short medley, and the first song is a rendition of Nina Simone, Tell Me More and More and Then Some. And the next song will be Ray Charles, Hit the Road Jack. We all know these were significant singers that definitely impact not only the genre, but they touched people with their music, with the lyrics, and with the soulful sounds. Blues, little bluesy jazz. Nina Simone was awesome. and then, I don't know if you're splitting them up, but the way the names were in there, we were gonna end with a new song by a young man, Elijah Blake, called Hanging Tree.
Thank you.
We don't want everybody to get up and leave. All right. Very good. Once again, Charlotte Brown and her trio. So we go from the blues and we make a very easy transition into the gospel. And any presentation of the gospel would be remiss if we didn't honor and pay homage to the father of gospel, Mr. Thomas A. Dorsey. So we have a short video clip of Thomas Dorsey that we're going to... live performance. This is live presentation here. So if we can have Ms. Carolyn Hollins and Chip Blackshear be followed by Mr. Alfred Golden. Give a hand for Carolyn and Chip.
Thank you.
Stop messing with me out here.
How great thou art.
Black History Month, and we got church in, so you know, I want them calling. Oh, amen. We have our AV working again, and I just want to give this presentation. For those of you who know and maybe some don't, I want to introduce to you the ministry of Mr. Thomas A. Dorsey, who's widely regarded as the father of gospel
music. Say something to your neighbor about God. If you can't, don't know God, you need to start over again.
Well, thank God for Professor Dorsey. He's the only one that would dare to make gospel music what it has become today. He took the church music, spirituals, and hymns, and kept them up, put a rhythm to them, and called it gospel. He was the first one to write and publish gospel songs. Before Mr. Dorsey, they didn't call me gospel singer. I was just a spiritual singer, a revival worker. And he said, if you listen to me, you can go far. And he didn't want the second best. So he's rough as P.I. He wanted you to be good or nothing. And you know, we didn't have the freedom to sing gospel in our churches. But Dorsey got us together and told us who we were. He was the first one to organize the Gospel Singers Convention. The convention came out of the people struggling, trying to get together. And Dorsey said, you get in here, we'll help you. And I made some of the best missionaries that you ever want to find.
They call me the father of gospel music.
Thomas A. Dorsey. They come out of experience in him, that's what he said. There's no son that could equal Precious Lord. He wrote Precious Lord when he was discouraged and his spirit was broken.
It was in a revival. And wife was to become a mother. I went away with the feeling that she'd make a lovely, lovely mother when I came back. I knew my people were well when I left home. And they sent for me to come to the door. I said, boy, I brought me in the telegram. I took it and read it. I almost fell out. Just hurry home. Your wife just died. I don't know how you would accept that. I couldn't accept it at all. And a friend of mine put me in the car. Took me home. I got home. I jumped out and ran in to see if it was really true. And one of the girls just started crying and said, Nettie just died, Nettie just died, Nettie just died, and fell on the floor. Their baby was left alive. But in the next 2 days, the baby died. Now, what should I do then and there? And then they tried to tell me the things that would be soothing to me. But none of it's never been soothing to me from that day to this day. But two fellows come by, I forget their names, they were friends of mine. And they were telling me about it. And I says, I don't know what to do and I don't know how to do. And just try to make my little talk to the Lord, but it was wasted, I think. And I called the Lord some one day, and one of the others said, no, that's not his name, say Precious Lord. So that just sounded good. And it got several amens on Precious Lord. And ladies and gentlemen, believe it or not, I started singing right then and there, Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, and let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn.
Precious
Mr. Thomas A. Dorsey. Precious Lord is a song that many of you remember that was sung by Mahalia Jackson at the Poor People's March in 1963, led by Martin Luther King in Washington, D.C. And it was also the song that was sung at the funeral of Dr. Martin Luther King, again, sung by Mahalia Jackson. It's just a song that's embedded in our culture, in our history, and I just thought we'd be remiss if we didn't pay homage to Mr. Thomas Dorsey in our recollection of our musical journey. Next, we go into the jazz period, and you can see this progression of the music as it continues to evolve. With the jazz music, it represented a time when the social movement of the day was being captured in the jazz music. There was a sense of rebellion, but also resignation in the jazz, that the situations that existed were there, but it was also a commitment to making the change. Came about during a time called the Harlem Renaissance, when there was a resurgence of black cultural excellence in the land. Many writers and poems, Langston Hughes, Zora Neale Thurston, a lot of writers and poets began to emerge and gave a new voice to the black experience. And jazz was born from that, but one of the things that jazz did was that it was a unifier, because in the jazz music, whites began to gravitate toward the music and to the sound. And so it was sort of an underground music, because at a time when blacks and whites couldn't get together in clubs and couldn't get together in social settings, they would get together in private meetings and in these speakeasies and back rooms, and blacks and whites would forget about all of the segregation and the discrimination of the time, and they would come together and just for the joy of the music. So jazz represented a stepping stone in our culture and in our evolving as a unified group of people. And many of the jazz leaders of that day, both black and white, began to play on each other's music. They began to collaborate on different musical presentations, and a lot of that still carries on to this day. The father, one of the guys that's recognized as the father of jazz music, let's go to the next video, please. This was Andre Crouch, but we're running a little bit behind, and I want to make sure that we get to the other presentations. So this is Shirley. No, go ahead. Shirley Barrett and Old Freedom. She represents the link into the classical music realm. Leontine Price and some others were very prominent in showing the full range of musical excellence of the African American and the black entertainer.
Civil rights.
uprising was gaining steam, and as the protests, the nonviolent protests were continuing on in the South and then moving to the North, it was this type of music that was the underpinning, that was like groundwork, that was the foundation of the civil rights movement. So you can see the line that's drawn. That. You can see the line that's drawn from the field slaves and how they use music to fuel those efforts in the slaves, even in the civil rights movement, how important music was in the civil rights movement and in building that and giving that power and in giving that strength. So music has always had that effect, and we just wanted to point that out and make sure that you're aware of the synergy. And the timeline and how there is a progression of the music from slave to spirituals to gospel to the blues and now to jazz. Again, as I was mentioning, this fellow Joe Morton is considered one of the fathers of jazz, and could we just have a little short presentation of Joe? We won't do the whole video, but I'll give you just an intro to it. Jazz music. With that, we're going to bring Mr. Chip Blackship to come up and give us a presentation, followed again by Mr. Shamalo Brown.
I mean, history. He's actually
one of the... Alfred Golden will come and give the jazz presentation. I'm looking at you, Shamalo, I'm thinking about
The person I want to mention earlier is Duke Ellington. Now, made history of jazz. He's actually on a coin, on one of the quarters. If you look at it, he had a chance to conceive to the balls. Serious coins. He actually is on there in Washington, D.C. So I just want to do a brief rendition of a song.
Let's give Sam a big hand. That was And now, Albert Golden will join him at the mic.
Understand.
father was very instrumental in the establishment of the nationally recognized Dr. Martin Luther King holiday. He pushed for that for many, many years. He lobbied the White House, he lobbied Congress, our representatives to establish January 15th as Martin Luther King Day. And so I just thought that in this type of a presentation, we'd be remiss if we didn't give some homage to Stevie Wonder for the great work that he's done. He's been a great activist for civil rights and has not been afraid to step out and take the spotlight for some controversial or seemingly controversial, I don't think they're controversial, but seemingly controversial stands on behalf of the plight of all of the oppressed, not just African Americans, but also for those in our LGBT community, for women's rights, for all of the areas and our minorities that have suffered through oppression and prejudice. He's been a champion for them, and so I just wanted to take that time. Now, at this moment, I want to ask if Ms. Shanelle Brown could come, and they're going to give us a song that we follow by Alfred Golden and Chev Blackshear and Carolyn Hollins, and then we're just going to have a good old time. Yeah, right here in Village Hall.
All right. This song is called Hanging Tree by a young man named Elijah Blake. And, well, I'm just going to keep it going. Please stop being.
That's all right.
like to ask Tev to come up, and it's just three chords in this whole song. I can't go out like that, hanging a tree.
Musicians, and we're going to join in a grand finale to get you up, shake, clapping your hands and stomping your feet, and then we've got some presentations that we want to make here at the end. So we're right at 3 o'clock. We started a little late, so give me about 10, 15 minutes, and we'll get you guys on your way. How's that? All right? Yes, we have the raffles, right. We're not raffles, but the door prizes in the presentation. So we will get right on that. Mr. Alfred Golden.
Y'all know this song. Oh.
Ladies and gentlemen, we want to thank you for coming to our presentation. We want you to hold on for a minute because we have some door prizes and some special recognitions and presentations that we would like to make. So it's not over yet, and I know you're having a great time, but if you'll bear with us for a few more minutes, we will get you on your way. Hey, we're the same. Members of our Sister Cities Committee, Ms. Mary Harrison and Ms. Pamela Fowler, who are going to proceed with this part of our day. Please hold on because you may be sitting on the lucky ticket, and we have some wonderful, wonderful door prizes.